Right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back. Game number three here, and it's best of three. It's the decided time, lower bracket. So whoever loses this is out of the running to qualify for ESL One Frankfurt this year. And it's unfortunate because Fantastic Five, you know, Havost and the lads up against No Diggity, Cinder and the boys. Let's see exactly what's going to come out on top. Void, Nature's Prophet, Wisp and Earthspirit all banned out. The first pick, Lone Druid from Cinder. But F5, Beastmaster, Enchantress, and my co-caster, Ryu. That's a good opener.
Oh, yeah. All right, so...
Are you okay there?
After that last game, I was just like, can No Diggity kind of get back into this? I was just so amazed by them, and I put all my hopes in them, but then I saw Havoth, King of the Roost. So, I'm good. Just here, chilling like a villain. Radiant. Lone Druid plus Invoker now. So they're going to have the setup combination of... nothing.
Root into something. Come on. You press the root button, you get a sunstrike, and you kill people. Like, I actually was wondering...
Is he going to survive long enough? So who runs this? I don't think Era runs it. Yeah. Keizu runs the Beastmaster, so it should be put in the off lane unless they do...
Wrong way around. No Diggity has a Lone Druid Invoker, not the Beastmaster.
Oh, that's what I meant. Sorry, I meant the Lone Druid. See, this is why you're here to help me. Lone Druid's being played by Keizu, not Era.
Yeah, I believe so.
And I don't even think they can get away with it in the safe lane. Beastmaster and Enchantress is just going to roll them unless they get like a Seum or something to help out that lane. I suspect Fantastic Five to ban out Seum and pot them here or something. Okay. So not going to take away the counters, instead just taking away the extra, push and potential mechanism. So it's like Death Ball versus Death Ball. Who's going to win, Durka?
That'd be funny. Win? Fourth ban out from F5. I think the Crystal Maiden's still a good shout just against the Enchantress and the Beastmaster. Good against both of them. But I was kind of wondering when the Lone Druid was first picked, because Quick for Hands run it mid from time to time. But with the Invoker, it's pretty certain that Quick was going to be the Invoker and they put the Lone Druid towards the offlane. I don't know. It's a tough fifth ban here from F5. There are so many options to go for.
You just have to kind of give a little bit of respect over to Yapzor and his Pottom. But as I talked about, the CM is still a great ban for them. You mentioned it last game. Disruptor could have been one of the best picks. It got banned out. In this game, it's still not bad, especially against the Lone Druid. If you can start glimpsing him back early on and, catching him out. Also, the Witch Doctor is, stock and stable. Don't know if they want to play against that. Odie is really good against the Lone Druid in the safe lane. You just Astro his bear, he can't pull. 5 seconds. But we saw how Fantastic, or both teams, kind of like sucked it up with the Odie. Everybody's saying, oh, Odie's OP. It didn't look like it in the last two games.
Definitely struggled a fair amount, but I think it's just coming around to teams, figuring what the weakness is. Like with Drow Draft back in the day, the old Drow Visage, and then people realize that you could actually deal with it. With the OD now, it's like, well, we pick a physical damage-dealing right-click carrier that just, destroys you. We get like an Oracle with Fate's Edict so you can't hit us. We get a Batrider with Sticky Napalm so you can't turn around and do your thing. There's just these little things that people have realized to deal with the OD. It's not that difficult as long as you get the right draft for yourselves and have the heroes that can actually handle them during laning stage or the mid-game team fights. But F5, they're going to add into their pushing power here with the Death Prophet, but it will be a Yapzor Morana again. He's had some pretty good games with this Morana recently, but it's going to be a tough one. I don't know if he's going to play the same kind of game where he looks for the Enchantress and tries to pick off her creeps and kill them off, or if he will be aiming towards killing Death Prophet mid, because we've seen DPs really struggle when they go like 0-4 mid lane and get killed off a bunch.
Yeah, I just love the DP here. Might still see the Oracle come out here. As you said, DP does kind of fall off a bit, but she can still add that pressure when you're pushing towers still. The silence is always great in the later stage. So the hero is not like a Viper, where if you go 0-3 or 0-4, you're not going to be crippled for the rest of the game and you just automatically lose. You still have some of the comeback potential there with the silence, and as well as Spirit Siphon, OP, put it on like four different heroes. Looks like you have like four legs or something walking around, or just that octopus suit on. Who thought of making that octopus?
It's fine.
What? Nah, it's... I mean, you can't even get anything in Dota from the last Winter's Chest. Honestly, who here got a rare?
No,
Me.
I'm salty. I didn't get Jack, but Ryu, you like anime, don't you?
Yeah, I like anime.
But you don't like
tentacles. That doesn't mean I watch hentai octopus stuff.
You don't like tentacles?
No. What does it look like? I'm broke back, remember? How can I watch tentacles if I'm broke back? Never mind. I'll take that back. All right. My imagination's going wild, guys. It's all thanks to Durka.
Wait, what kind of broke back? Twitch emote broke back or broke back mountain broke back?
Like,
both?
Both? Octopus guy. Okay, we're going to just get. We're just moving on.
What is going on in your head? What is going on in your head here? Dear Lord. Tusk is picked up by F5, so that's going to be like their kind of roaming duo support, I guess. Enchantress and Tusk, just trying to kill people off as much as they possibly can. It does mean they don't have a static lane support, so it's going to have to be action on all stations for F5. And no diggity, is it time for a saving support? It's time for a Witch Doctor to slow down these creeps and maybe try and stall up any pushes that do come in from F5. They're still looking for their one roll here for Era. And F5's the same story, right? Still looking for their Havost hero.
It's just funny how, like, you're talking about, like, in one game or one series, nobody prioritizes the bounty hunter. Remember how we saw the resurgence and also the Doom versus the Enchantress? But in this series, it's more about Yapzor's Mirana being kind of like his signature thing here. And, yeah, I'm very interested to see what these last picks are going to be for the cores. And that's nice for no diggity here. You can always counteract the last one. I'm thinking either Weaver for Fantastic Five. Ooh. Okay, well, I wasn't going to think of that.
Well, there's nothing to stop it, is there? Like, what do you do now? Do you go Bristleback or a Tide or a Doxia? It's a rough spot to be in, as no diggity. The fifth pick, Brood. That's going to put the shivers into you.
Time to win by 20 minutes. We're all going to go home early, guys. Or it could just be Fantastic Five, you know, putting their heads against the wall, and then they just fall over flat with a concussion. So it's going to be like a 25-minute game where Fantastic Five come out on top, or, you know, 50-minute game I see where No Diggity kind of come out.
I have a feeling that Sindarin's going to dip very deep into this reserve time. 1 minute, 40 seconds. You need time to think about this. You're just being fifth pick brooded.
So there's... You could still go for... I think Ember Spirit's not that bad. I think Ember Spirit is the pick here for No Diggity. They can catch out the Brood with the Searing Chains. You have the Flame Guard to help out clear out the creeps. Once you get the Battle Fury, you're going to be able to hold high ground. And it's going to allow you to be able to split push effectively with the Boots of Travel, and then you can come to team fights. So best hero right now is... It has to be that. Nothing else is... can come close. Or if they, like you said, want to just go toe-to-toe with the Brood, then maybe the Darkstar are tied.
You tried this in game one. Double or nothing? Because you're saying Ember Spirit or nothing, right? And it's the Tidehunter. Lucky you didn't bet on it.
No. Sometimes you just think, like, what can we counter it in the laning phase, or what can we counter it at, you know, 20, 25 more minutes? But... they still have the potential to kill the Brood. It's just going to be a safe lane Brood is the problem. And you're going to have to find ways to deal with it. And if they put Lone Druid in the bottom lane, he would just die constantly to the Enchantress Beastmaster maybe. And then you're leaving your Ember Spirit top lane with the tri lane. And you have to get kills on Brood for that to work out. Whereas the Tidehunter, he could just stay up there. And are they going to have...
Give me the one roll Tusk. Oh, it's not happening. Give me the one roll Beastmaster.
Give me the one roll Enchantress mid back in the days of Dota 1.
Dearing me.
That would be fun.
So it's Era switching back onto the Invoker, Koigva, Lone Druid, and everything else is pretty much as standard there for them. Okay. Yol Enchantress. So it's going to be Havost safe lane Beastmaster then. Or at least he's going to be the farming role.
I hope so. But it could be just dying roll.
Oh, dear. But I guess this is how they have to do it, right? Because it has to be all-out aggression. They have to win their lanes, they have to push forward, and they're not allowed to die. If they die, they give away a lot of gold to invoke a Lone Druid. Tidehunter gets into these Ravagers. Defending towers in the early stage of the game, not easy for No Diggity. But as the game progresses, It does feel like they've got pretty good high ground defense, especially with this Invoker getting himself up and running. Well, the Sunstrike
forward.
They don't
have any great, like you say, wave clear for no diggity, so they're kind of banking on, you know, a coconut here to help pull off the creep waves or something, and maybe setting up with an arrow or a ravage from behind. A lot on the line for this game here. Game three. Waited a long time to cast this. It's definitely turning out to be a great one here, Durka, where anyone can take it here. Are Diggity going to lose to a cheese strategy, or are they going to be able to survive? I asked you the question, who wins?
Yes, you did ask me that question. And for the answer, we'll have to wait.
Oh, you cop out, you son of a simple son of a...
Until the game ends, and then we'll know for sure. But it's going to be Kezu. Maybe gets caught out. Snowball forward, picks up Yorl, throws BZZ over onto Koik for Havos. He's going to try and catch out this lone druid. He's being dropped low by the Spirit Siphon. He's going to get chased into the death, but he's finally taken out with the Sunstrike forward. Kezu's still trying to batter into BZZ, but the Fairy Fires will keep him alive. One more clip from Yapzor. Not enough. Doesn't kill him. And now the rest of F5s are actually in the thick of things, brawling away at Sindarin. But it's just going to be the one death for now. Maybe RMN, with another snowball, can get himself out of this dodgy spot, but the arrow flies across and he does dodge away from it, so there's nothing killing him just here. And F5, they get in, they get out, they shake it all about, but the Sunstrike is going forward, not going to catch him. But RMN goes back in to try and steal the bounty, and he gets it as well! RMN, you cheeky little bastard! Snowballs in, loses his life, but still... He got his boots, he bought himself a TP scroll, and he's perfectly happy with this. Well, up at the top bounty rune, denied by Koikva. Takes it out of the hands of the Broodmother, or the claws, or the mandibles, or whatever you want to call them. The spiky little legs. And now the lanes can reset, and everyone can be happy. Because Kezu, he's going to find out shortly that he's not against the Broodmother, so he's going to have to buy a TP and move up towards top lane. Just Ghostick, she's up there. Well, Havost is down here with the Beastmaster, the offlane Beastmaster, safe lane Broodmother. BZZ mid on the DP. And Yol with RMN, they've got a pair of smokes here between them. I think they're going to be playing aggro once more. So you've got three solo laners here from F5. Well, no Diggity have something a little more standard.
No, just going for that roaming Mirana mid here. He already missed the arrow. Going to be placing a ward here for Yapzor. So he's not going to play defense. And that's going to be a very big thing if they get this gank off here. It's going to help out the Beastmaster a lot. Era is so weak as an Invoker. Oh, it's looking bad for no dig.
Sindarin, he's got Cask of Voodoo Restoration. He's going to be the target here, actually, with a stun bouncing back and forth. The Ice Shards will trap him in. RMN got that level 2 at a good timing, and Sindarin dies. RMN, Snowball. No. Very close to cancelling out the TP from Era, but not fast enough. On the fingers there from the Tusk, and his clarity gets cancelled out by the cheeky little range creep as well. And how are the other lanes going? DP against Lone Druid. How does this match up?
It's about even. DP can put a lot more pressure on. And the CS advantage can go the way of either one, whoever plays it better. It's hard to last hit against. It's kind of like 90 damage coming in from a Lone Druid at times. But... you know, you have the creep wave clear with BZZ and the rune control potential from him. So I would give the edge for the DP just because of the runes until he gets that level 5 and the unlucky roots could end everything.
Look at this Radiant jungle. Enchantress and Tusk. They're moving themselves across as well, looking for another range, another large creep here for Yol. But 15 seconds on the enchant. He's got to wait a little while. There's actually no Hellbear there. It's been taken out already. This is something that Yapzor can do. He can go around taking out the large creeps from these camps with his arrow, not only getting himself golden experience, but also taking away this aggressive potential from Yol.
Oh, and they just rotated lanes. This is such a good idea coming for F5. They're going to put the Brood bottom lane here. It's going to force Era to either rotate out a lane, and if he's forced to rotate to the top lane with the Invoker, he can be picked off. So... I like what they're doing from F5, making sure the Invoker rotates and putting him in harm's way.
Era still does have this Sunstrike to throw, but...
Uh-oh, Durka's robot.
Oh, well, that's something we're just going to have to deal with. Blame Skype. Blame whatever. Era, TPing out. Gets himself away, there's no stun forthcoming from Yolt. Snowball in, RMN tries to body block up Kezu. The trap is there from the troll. The Centaur is going to try and walk into range, but the Tidehunter is tanky. He gets himself back. His lane swaps coming in and out, though. No, Diggity, they're always on the back foot, always the ones that have to get themselves out of these sticky situations.
Yeah, like you said, they're playing reactive Dota right now from no dig, so that's benefiting F5 being one step ahead. And I thought maybe Invoker would be punished a little bit more here, but they tried to go for these kills on the bottom lane, and they don't really have a smoke right now to really work with for F5. And Koifa's obviously managed to dodge gain. And look at this, 2 points in Savage Roar so he can get away. Playing extra super defensive, but Yapzor, he wasted his leap. Oh, this is a dead pot if I've ever seen one. Poor Priestess.
Tries to kill off a creep before dying. But this is the great thing, right? We're talking about how No Diggity have to move themselves around to swap these lanes up. But every time they swap, they move Era, they move the Mirana, they move the Witch Doctor. These guys are all wasting time, wasting money on TPs to move lanes. But the fact you have these two floating supports, the Tusk and the Enchantress, they aren't locked down onto any lanes. So they can stay in one spot, they can stay in the Radiant Jungle, they can gank mid, they can gank bottom lane. It's just one hero at a time. It's the Beastmaster and the Broodmother. So it's two heroes instead of like the three or four that No Diggity have to move. So it's always that economic advantage as well that F5 are gaining here. And you can kind of see it in the last hits. Is Era in trouble? No, it's Havost. Forced back and the arrow from Yapzor. Point blank range to the face and he buys up his Arcane Boots. At long last, No Diggity gets something out of the laning stage.
Can you rehost the call real quick? Because you're a robot to me.
I can indeed. Let's see if that fixes anything. Ryu?
No, you're still a robot.
Oh,
please,
dear.
Durka, please.
I cannot do anything. I cannot do anything to fix this. The internet. It's a weird and wonderful place, but sometimes it just ruins your day. So you're just going to have to guess what I'm saying and try and sound intelligent while up towards a little ramp here. Snowball dodge out from the arrow. Koikva. Snowball onto the bear, but RMN will escape with his life. This lone druid. What's he got? Gloves of Haste. Heading into the Midas as quickly as he can, but yol. Enchantress comes back across. Dark Troll as well as the Hellbear Smasher. Might be aiming towards a gank onto Koik for pre-level 6. He is very squishy on his hero. They've also got that BZZ Spirit Siphon as well, but he's going to get scouted out by Yapzor. So the Mirana spots the Enchantress, and that gank isn't going to come to anything.
Man, it's so hard going off what you said. I hear like half of it. Oh, feel so bad now. Top lane though, Avos is going to be picked off, gets the roar. Is he going to get away here?
He can't escape from this, surely not. He sells himself up and he's fine. The Tusk is coming in from the south as well, and RMN, he's aiming for the Regoose because DP, era. BZZ has made his way in as well. The TP scroll, Era, there's no way. Try to block yourself out. There's the Forge Spirit, TP available, but the Hawk will give vision here for RMN to snowball if he really needs to. And you cannot get yourself away from this one with Era. Right click down by Havost. Fantastic five. Another good rotation from them.
Yep. Nice rotations coming in. Killing off Era. Shutting him down a little bit more. He's only got 26 CS. So shutting down the Invoker, it's key here in the early game because he's the one you can punish the most. And with him not having a fast Midas and having the levels up, it's kind of a useless hero. So it's kind of on the backs of Koifa to really step it up. And Keizu is like that person who's gonna have to make rotations, but if he goes for those rotations, you know, we could see a fast tier 2 tower going down for Ghost Stick. So they're gonna have to make some, you know, decisions here for the side of No Diggity and fast.
Well, Keizu finally levels up his Ravage, level 8, he gets that one up. Went for the 0-3-4 build before actually going back into his ultimate. Well, BZZ makes good use of his ulti up at top lane. The arrow hits into the catapult. Yapzor doesn't get the opening that he kind of wished for up a top lane. While Lone Druid, he's being left to his own devices towards the mid. Getting into that Midas a little bit faster than maybe expected with the aggression coming from F5.
Alright, so I'm so happy. I just replugged in everything. Durka sounds golden now, boys. And like you said, this is... Oh, he just resummoned his bear for Koifa. And they pinging it out. They want to make something happen here now. BZZ doesn't have his ulti. I feel like if they did, they would instantly dive Koifa right now.
Savage Roar sends him away, brings it back, and he took out the Illusion Rune. He's going to go and take the Bounty Rune as well, denying both of them from Fantastic Five. But Broodmother, how's she doing? Sitting at level 8, Ghost Stick. They're sending Spirelings up and down, but Sol Ring into Orchid looks like it's the item of the day. That Orchid could lead to some pretty juicy kills over on the Invoker and the Witch Doctor, who right now, they're not going to have any way of dealing with it. The Yule Scepter for Era is miles off. Still going to try and head into the Midas, it looks like, with the Gloves of Haste. But Ring of Akhtar with the Null Talisman.
Nice arrow.
And first hit Entangle. The snowball forward. BZZ wants to try and turn this one around. Going for Spirit Siphon. Look at the damage output of that. Savage Roar's not going to do a bloody thing. BZZ sent back to his own side of the river. But Koikva shredded. Impetus damage with Spirit Siphon. Way more than enough to kill off him, even during that true form.
Oh, the courier. My courier. My faceless. Rex. All right, it's fine. Good. Speed burst away. And this cheeky Broodmother just going around the map, being a nuisance. Oh, man. I don't even want to play against Fantastic's 5 lineup. They're just everywhere around the map right now. And they are just putting on the pressure, like, nonstop here. BZZ's ulti's up in 15 seconds. Can No Diggity hold this tower?
It's going to be tall order, honestly. Like, they've got Sunstrike from Era, and he's closing in on level 8, so the double Forge Spirits will be here soon. But it feels like it's all a case of whether Yapzor hits an arrow or not. If he doesn't hit an arrow, I don't think they can. But if he does, then they could win the fight outright. It's such a tough spot to be in, while Ghost Digger's cutting waves at bottom. I'm making sure the Tidehunter's going to have a rough time defending his own tier 1. Oh, Yol. Scouted. Nice little Observer Ward there as well from No Diggity. Going to give a little bit of vision of him. And it's up at top lane. Havosa's aiming and ready with this roar. RMN is lurking in the background looking for him as well.
No Diggity. Cheeky Savage Roar. There you go, Koifa. Steals the bounty rune from
Again?
BZZ. He's not happy.
That's like the fourth rune he's taken with that. I'm going to try and dive in on bottom. Kezu. Chunk of damage from Impetus Shots. I'll get himself behind this tower, though. The Centaur's moving on in, and Yol pops the sprite. Just keeps throwing these Impetuses down onto Kezu, but he stands his ground. He's not going to take that much damage if he gets closer to her. Yapzor will TP in, arrow down the Centaur, make sure there's no further dives here either. But it's become an offlane Invoker now, Ryu.
Oh,
the snowball of the Forge Spirit, that's nothing. RMN's not going for this. Lone Druid finally finishes up his Midas, 10, 11 minutes in. Era.
He's pressuring up here. He snowballed already though, so Era's kind of safe.
They've got the stun into Sunstrike, but it's not well timed, and RMN, the cask. Bounces back onto the Cold Snap, but there should be a Deny Tower here. There's No Diggity. Wait for the Catapult to hit in one more time. I'm going to try and dive Yapzor, though, I think. Pinging down and aiming for this Tier 1. It's kind of surprising the Broodmother hasn't killed the tower yet.
Damn it, I'm just going to have to turn you up. Freaking robot, Durka. Hold on. I'm going to restart my Skype real quick. All right.
Bye. He's not coming back. He's dead. Rip Ryu, gone forever. Forever in our hearts. Well, tier 1 mid, still going to get pushed in here. Yol, you've got to stop tanking this tower. You're dropping very low, and one Sunstrike. A stray hit out there, or maybe a Ravage from Kezu. They ping him out. They know he's there with his good Observer Ward, giving vision across, and he will not be able to initiate. Just Anchor smashes his way through a couple of those creeps. Tough going, though, for them, as Era is kind of forced to sit back and farm the camp. And he decided not to go for the Midas. He went back for the Power Treads. So they know that they need this early to mid-game potential just to stand and fight, especially around their Tier 2s. It's Fantastic Five. They're not going to give up too easily. The big question is all around this Roshan. How fast, how easily will they actually be able to take it? I do T-tours as I'm trying to recall Ryu. Getting back in. What was that? A kill on Yapzor. Ghost Stick, first Orchid usage of the game. Kezu has his mech and his arcanes done. For now, it's just F5 trying to build into their bigger items. Necro 1. It might come down to this point here where they've got all their kind of tier 1 items coming through. Not tier 1 items, but like their primary items at the very least. It's Kezu, Orchid with the Impetus Shots through. I don't know if they've got reveal here to actually see him as he gets into the Moonlight Shadow. When they don't, they're not going to know he's dipping himself away. There's no one left to actually come in and try and contest this, and Tidehunter, even with a Ravage, he's not able to fight.
Thank God. Oh, I love you. Restarting everything helped. Oh, I can hear you. I can understand when you ask me questions now.
Amazing.
So, what happened?
Nothing. Like, Mirana died bottom lane.
Oh my God, you're a robot again. What the... I'm done.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know.
You were fine for 10 seconds when you were talking, and then all of a sudden, it got robot again.
I have no idea. Well, Roshan goes the way of Fantastic Five. BZZ picks up Aegis and Yule Scepter. This Death Prophet, too strong right now. 1-0-2, 75 last hits, 6k net worth. They need to keep this momentum up, though, Fantastic Five, as Yol walks into the Lone Druid. There's one hit. The Spirit Bear tries to chunk away at Yol, but level 4 untouchable means it's so damn hard for Koikfer to actually do anything. And with the arrow flying, not landing onto that actual hero, hitting the Satyr instead, the Hawks up over the trees, giving vision for F5 as well. But in the meantime, Syndra and Era up on top lane, take a tier 1, get themselves a nice bit of money, and also split pushing away.
Yeah, their split pushes coming into, at least this time they can do it with Forged Spirits, and you have the Lone Druid once he has the Radiant, so they're on good timing to at least having different ways. Like we saw last game where they had this 5-man lineup, they couldn't do anything around the map. This time they can, so it's nice to see them change up the draft here a little bit, but still, your towers are going to get melted away here once the DP ulti starts kicking in, once the Necro 3 starts kicking in. Alright.
No Diggity, it looks like they're just going to try and split push this out. Hold on to your tier 2s as long as you can, but you can't really commit for the defense here as the arrow lands, but tier 2's already gone. Level 4 in the Inner Beast with a DD rune on BZZ. Exorcism back up in 30 seconds as well, means that they can go in for another tower anytime they want to, really. They want to move in up towards top, though. Stop Era and Syndra from having such a good and easy time up towards top, because they've been left alone for a good couple of minutes now. I'll TP themselves away.
Syndra, though. Staying.
Why is
staying.
He still here?
Oh.
What? Could they see him?
I think they got vision from Crypt Swarm or something. It was something I don't really notice is when I play DP, I didn't notice you could get vision with Crypt Swarm, so I'm not 100% there, guys. I thought they could see him beforehand, mid lane though. Gonna TP out, and what are we playing? It's a Bloodseeker lineup here? No Diggity, just TPing away from everything.
Oh, what stuns do they have? Beastmaster, Roar, Snowball. I guess the Yule Scepter from the DP helps out with that one, but there's not that many. Straight up stuns from F5. As Era, Yule Scepter is pretty damn close actually. Good against the Yule Scepter and also good at setting up kills. Onto heroes like the Death Prophet, who, you know, she's very squishy. She's very squishy. 1,000 health at this point. Needs to start tanking up and looking for those HP items. But we're yet to see Kezu really get into the thick of things and use this Ravage and the Greaves. But no Diggity, I think they're kind of happy with the way things are going so far. It's 2-6, 16 minutes in. They're still holding onto two of their tier 2s. And as long as it keeps at this pace, they're farming decently. They're keeping their Lone Druid with his Midas, moving into the Relic and into that Radiance at a decent rate. I don't see this as being an awful game here for No Diggity. It's just how quickly F5 accelerate into taking down tier 3s and racks that's going to be the issue. Or maybe if they find Koikfer, Orchid is there and RMN traps him with the Ice Shards. BZZ's popping his ultimate for this one as well. The arrow flies across and the Yule Scepter cancels the TP. So Loon Druid, oh dear. He is absolutely Shrek's. And they kill off the Spirit Bear as well. So 300 experience and gold goes the way of F5. Well, where was that?
He was pressuring the tower, but he got set up into the combo with the Yules, burned to death by a meteor. That sounds very painful, actually. It's not even like getting crushed by a meteor, it's like burned to death. Ooh.
Sad stuff for Havost. And he was all alone. He knew the rest of his team had kind of moved towards the mid lane to try and find that Lone Druid. Ghoststick, he's nearly got his BKB completed. That's clear indication that they want to try and fight and finish this game as early as they possibly can. I mean, the next step up would be going for Necros and stuff like that for an all-in strat here. But Beastmaster's Necros up to 3 now are going to be the only ones on the field, while a point booster for BZZ signals the direction he's going into that nice little Octarine core. And I'm wondering, RMN, he's got himself a buckler and a wand. I don't know if he's going to be going into the mech or if that's just going to be a casual buckler, because he does have the arcanes for the Greaves as well if he wants to. A Dragon Lance up for the Enchantress, and she'll start pumping out a ton of damage from decent range as well. But no Diggity. What do you think their chances are, Ryu, in actually holding out on a high ground push?
if they have the Radiance online before they go high ground, I think they have a really good chance of just kind of stalling here. The Bear is going to start doing a lot of DPS. They have, like, talked about the Yules on Era, and they're closing in on the Blink Dagger. It's more for me, what is F5 going to do? Are they going to try to split push, like, four people on one side and then the Brood on the other, and just try and take one Rex in, like, rat fashion? Or are they going to try to five-man barrel down and try to contest Diggity's five-man?
Keizu's going to have his Blink Dagger soon. See, he's a big army of Spiderlings there. But Ghostick wisely staying in the trees, making sure that you're just farming safely. Oh, BZZ. Oh, that's the full soul booster done. That Octarine Core is not far away. I think the next Roshan in 2 minutes is going to be a key pivotal moment here for F5. Just take the Aegis and make sure that they can breach the high ground with that one. And for now, it's just looking at the tier 2 bottom lane. They're all grouping up. Maybe aiming for Keizu as well. Tidehunter's 90 gold away from the Blink. It'll just be the five-man down the bottom lane. Get the tier 2, and then, you know, swarm through the jungle, move up towards the top, and try and find any stragglers over towards the side.
But yeah, that's at least a good play coming out from Koifa here. Just going to go free farm in the top lane. They can't contest this tower at all. Need to have the Radiance online. There's just no way, and I'm glad BZZ's not popping Exorcism for this one. I was kind of curious why he popped it for the top one when they had, you know, Necro 2 and with Havos having the Inner Beast. I thought they could just take it down and then maybe pop the Exorcism for the tier 3. But it looks like they're ready to go. They don't need Roche. They don't need anything. They're like, hey, baby, we want this tower. We want this game now.
Well, go for it. Tier 3 breach. The Radiance is up 20 minutes in. Not an awful timing here for them, but the Moonlight Shadow, the jump in, the Ravage catches onto BZZ, but nobody else. Meteor down onto BZZ. Down goes the DP. No! Kept alive? Not long enough. RMN. Maybe trying to turn this one around with a BKB from Ghostick. No Diggity. They've held their high ground, and Havost, the Roar, back onto Keizu. Tries to DP himself away, but the stun... Where is it? Where's the cast? Nothing stopping him. Ice Wall will slow down Yol, and the jump forward from Keizu will catch the Enchantress as well. And fantastic five. All of a sudden, crumbling.
They were not ready for that Blink Dagger at all. Oh my goodness. Caught down, and they had a lot of chances to maybe save him if you talked about when if Armin had his mechanism, but he doesn't have that yet. The snowball kind of looked nice, but he was forced to instantly go and go. And then this is the problem with their lineup. It's all about timings. If you mess up one team fight like that, you give over so much to the enemy side of No Diggity, since they don't have that many towers, and it just gets them one step closer to having those items. And we talked about it, their late game is way better.
Oh, look at that arrow in the ice wall forward as well. The stun's coming forward. Yol, he's not dead just yet. Oh, the death ward dropped. Cinder, and he's looking for that kill, but the cancel comes out of RMN. The spirit softened back onto the spirit bear. That's RMN, dead to rights pretty much here. Turns back to fight, pops his buckler and says, well, if I'm going to go down, I'll go down fighting. Brawling through with the bear as well. But Koikva leaves the Radiance Burn going down on this creep wave. Maybe they look for BZZ. Arrow not going to catch onto him though. Death Prophet safe as houses back there. While Spiderlings, they are ready to be eaten. The bear is hungry. These spiders are so tasty as well. Look at that, all the gold going to him. Lone Druid picks up a chunk of cash. With 2,100 gold saved up, Koikva. Start looking for that Vlad's, get into the Assault Cuirass, and start thinking about his bashers and things like that.
I've been noticing a lot of teams going less and less for the Vlad's. First on Lone Druid, they just rush the Assault. But in this game, I wouldn't mind him just going for it straight up, adding that extra armor to the rest of his team. There's no other, you know, DPS or heavy right clicker, and Booker's more spell oriented this game, so they're not going to benefit as much from the healing, but it's still just nice to have these auras and the lifesteal onto the bear. So instead, I think the AC is going to help out a bit more here.
I mean, against the DP, you need that armor. It just depends how fast you need it or how fast you want it. There's the Vlad's fully done. So Koikva feels that he needs a little bit of boost right now, because F5, they're going to be ramping up and accelerating themselves towards these tier 3s and racks, especially once this Roshan has been taken and Aegis is being claimed, maybe by BZZ. Yapzor, Veil Mirana with the Arcane Boots. That's looking for the arrow across to give the vision. But the Hawks, the Boars, they're already out here from Havost, giving equal amount of vision, if not more, over onto No Diggity. And Yapzor reveals himself to the Hawk, but Keizu, he's here with a Blink Ravage, and he might be able to find a couple of them. There we go, he cancels animation. Nope, not going to go for it just yet. Havost, BZZ, RMN, there's the arrow across the brow of them, but Havost, he's caught Keizu, he's burning through his mana with a Necrunis, but he still gets the Ravage up to 3. Havost on the low ground with a Death Ward from on high. Havost is taken into the snowball, but not kept alive long enough, and with the bear burning the radiance onto these Necrunis, Keizu, they've got vision on him, they see him, oh, he's just about alive! Oh, in with a shot, the fade time, walks back in with the shards block him in, but the arrow barrel down to BCC, they've trapped him with the entangled into the root from the lone druid, bear turns back around and Koikva, oh, it's time for him to clean up, looks for another kill, ghosting his invis, just needs a little bit of a reveal back onto him, they get the Keizu back onto the broodmother, and Keizu keeps himself alive with stick and greaves and all that nonsense. Four heroes dead here from F5. One lost by No Diggity.
It looks almost... This is like 90% in Diggity's favor for closing out this game right now. It's looking so bad for F5. They just hit that timing where Keizu gets all this free farm from the Broodmother, setting up with the Blink Ravage, just turned this whole game upside down, and they're going to get the Roche now. F5, how are they going to get back into this game? Only way I'm seeing it is if they can manage to find split pickoffs around the map and try and go high ground in the next 10 minutes, because I just don't see this lone druid getting out carried by anything in the later stages of the game right now.
It was kind of an all-in draft, and like you said, once the first team fight failed down bottom racks, now the second team fight has not worked out for them. They have to commit for this Roshan and try and stop No Diggity from taking it under their noses, but the arrow will land onto BZZ. They jump forward and they've killed off BZZ! The Death Prophet shredded. Yabzor sets it all up with a deafening blast back. The roar onto Eril, keep him alive with the Greaves, but it's not quite enough. Taken out of the game by this combo here of Enchantress and Beastmaster, but the bloody bear! Look at the Radiance Burn! Takes down Havost. No! They micro it away. Trying to get RMN instead. Looks for the secondary kill, but the snowball back will only send him deeper into death. RMN is killed off. I just wonder if Ira was alive, if he goes for that Sunstrike onto Havost, but they want to go back into the Roche pit here, or do they? Koikva's thinking about it, but there's no Invoker and there are no Forge Spirits. With the Death Prophet alive once again, returns to the battle. 25 seconds until Exorcism is available for BZZ.
Regeneration for the bear, why not? Let's just give him a full life and a second bear to work with for the next team fight, and BZZ buying back. I mean, he was, what, like 1,000 gold off of having his Octarine, and then all of a sudden, nothing? Just absolutely nothing. And it's all coming down to this one last stand. BZZ, gonna have to be the man. He's gonna have to put this team fight on his back, but they have Ravage set up. He's gonna have to find a way to dodge it. Oh, the setup, the arrow.
They don't have anyone to blink forward, though. Keizu does have that Blink Ravage, but Ira was so far away there, he's coming back in again, and he's got his Meteor and Sunstrike ready to cast. There is the Sunstrike onto Yol. Should have the damage to kill him off. The Death Ward and the Starstorm is there, but the Exorcism onto the back. Cinderin is focused down, but Moonlight Shadow puts them under the guise of invisibility, and BZZ is having difficulty sticking on a target. He's walking to the middle of four of them. This Exorcism is doing a lot of damage. Ira is killed off in the back end by the Beastmaster. BZZ is trapped. The die back for him, and now the turn. They're going to chase these down. The Necro units will die. But No Diggity, can they catch anybody else? Havost, oh, he blinks back defensively away after summoning his boar and his hawk, giving vision across. But Roshan should belong to No Diggity here. Still holding onto the Ravage as well as that Gem of True Sight. Broodmother, Ghostick, I don't know if you try for the steal. Might be an option, but the arrow tanked by the Brood. They can't jump forward though, or can they? Yapzor, they've got the vision with the veil. Now the BKB pops, the Orchid is there, but Yapzor's walked into his own death. Mirana gives up her life. Maybe to secure Roshan, or maybe not. No Diggity, they retreat out of the pit.
Oh my goodness. How are they still in this game with BZZ going down like that? That's your heavy hitter. Oh, this is looking so good still for No Diggity. The ulti is still down from the DP, and they're just waiting for Koifa to rejoin them here. And you just see the difference in the Invoker. Oh, gonna have action. Havos might then get entangled.
Oh no, they aim back onto RMN. In the meantime, Roshan's been taken by Ghost Stick. They go for the punch of the cloak, but the blink ravage snowball dodges it out. He gets himself away, but Yol's still caught with the Sunstrike. The damage up is not good enough. Heals himself through, but Hovos roll back onto Cloakfer. Where is this DPS though? BZZ tries to Spirit Siphon forward, Deafening Blast onto Yol as well. Era, what's the damage? There's nobody dying. Impetus shots finally come through from Yol, but the Roshan's already been taken, and the Aegis picked up by the Brood. BZZ chased out as well. And there's the finally an entangle back from Cloakfer's bloody bear. A Syndra on the retreat out. The Witch Doctor dying slowly but surely, but the Ice Wall's trapped in Yol, and Keizu should be able to trap again onto this Enchantress and kill her off. But Syndra hiding from the Necro unit, the Spiderling blocks off the path. Three dead here from Fantastic Five, the two alive, Havost as well as Ghost Stick. The Broodmother focused down on the Roshan and took out the Aegis of the Immortal. But no Diggity, they're the ones with five alive. Are they the Fantastic Five?
Yeah, you can just see how it's really hard for them to win a team fight if DP is not the one doing all the work. And oh boy, Alacrity on my bear now. And they don't even need Aegis. That was just kind of like a little cute play there from Ghost Stick. But it's not going to help save your Raxes here at the end of the day.
And what does Aegis Broodmother even give you? Ghost Stick is still playing very passively in the back. They'll blink themselves away. No Diggity. Don't want to press the issue too much here. Even a defensive arrow to kill off the boar as well. They might decide to smoke up though. Maybe go back in again when they know there's no wards or hawks watching them. Instead, they'll pick up Era's Aghanim Scepter. AC over on the Lone Druid. It's just items flowing through. 4,000 gold over on Yapzor as well.
Yeah, normally they back out when two things. One, they want to kind of bait the enemy team out. Or two, they're just saving up for those big items. And Koifa just got his eggs, and they got the assault coming in for Koifa. It's going to help out tremendously. He talked about the armor helping out against the DP here. And this, oh my goodness, how F5, they need to have a smoke gank like ASAP. They need to get something done. But at the same time, Ghost Stick, is he going to feed? Yeah, he needs to farm up his assault too. And this should be go time for them. It's going to be hard fighting into a Ravage, but you're just going to have to try and find out somebody and pick them off, because we said, can't say it enough, F5 are still on a clock. I mean, let's think about it for here a little bit, Durka, right? You have the Enchantress who can potentially be a core in the later stages of the game, but she's not that close to her eggs, so she's not hitting like a truck yet. The Broodmother, she's getting there a little bit. But BZZ keeps dying in these team fights, having no item progression. It's just not enough to win this game.
When you're saying they're on a clock, I feel like the time has come and gone and the clock doesn't exist anymore. It's been destroyed.
They aren't even on the clock because they already lost. No.
It kind of feels that time is...
Yeah, I would say this game is 90% over in favor of No Diggity, just because the way they're going to itemize, and there's no way for them to pick off Tidehunter. And if you can't kill the Tidehunter, I don't see you winning the team fight. Like, there's no situation where you can jump on Tide and win. You just have to have like mass BKBs or something. And DP, as we talked about enough, she doesn't have the items. Enchantress going for that Ag, she's not gonna have the BKB. So it all comes down to maybe Armin having this huge Tusk snowball save on, you know, BZZ. We've seen him, but he's like dead already when he uses the snowball.
Oh, Era blinks forward, he's looking for RMN. No, the Yule Scepter down onto Enchantress. The Ice Wall Arrow. More than enough damage to kill him, and the Savage Roar. RMN's caught as well, his TP's cancelled out. They'll kill them off two for nothing. This Fantastic Five have no buybacks on their two supports. And you're saying that the Tusk is going to come down to his saves with a snowball. Well, he's not available anymore. So what do F5 do?
Yeah, how are they going to hold this with no D push besides the Crypt Swarm? And if BZZ gets caught out by a Ravage, he's going to go bye-bye. Ghost Stick hit by the arrow. They're going to ping it out here. But no, they're just going to get the Rax instead. No Fortify.
Brood still has Aegis, but again, what does Aegis Brood give you? There's no pressure, there's no power play, there's nothing here. As the jump forward from Kaze, we're looking for Ghost Stick again. He's still holding
on
to that gem.
4K gold on Yapzor? Oh my.
Yeah, he's been saving money for the past 10 minutes. He's just like, yeah, guys. I've got a load of cash, don't know what to buy with it. Exorcism. BZZ looking for the Spirit Siphon back on the Keizu. He's holding onto the Ravage though, looking for the go, but it's BKB from Havos kind of stopping this from happening. And Death Ward from Syndra drop now with a roll back onto Koikva. The Lone Druid Spirit Bear is killing off Ghost Stick. They don't really care. Havos is up in the front lines, but they're just dealing so much bloody damage back to him. The jump forward finally from Keizu catches them all. And Fantastic Five. All back in the fountain. Ghostick. Last one remaining, but slowed down by the ice wall, and GG is cool. 23 to 11. Era, can you make it 24? Doesn't look like he can. Ghostick will hide, dip himself back in, but it's game over. Ryu. No diggity win. 2-1.
Yeah, this is how we kind of thought it was going to play out. Once we saw that first game, it was like, oh, this is going to be no diggity show. And then all of a sudden, Fantastic Five, you know, kind of had their picks showing off with that Faceless Void and the Havos clinks. But when it's just coming down to, you know, team execution and decision making, it looks more crisp from no diggity and all around well played from them. And, you know, just one screw up with we talk about it, the one screw up with this kind of lineup, all in strategy, you're going to lose the game. It's like a Pugna strategy. It's like a Drow strategy. You got to hit those timing windows. The quota wasn't met, and, you know, you just flopped. So really well played from No Diggity, and they're going to be moving on. And I'm sad to say this, Durka, but I don't want to cast with you tomorrow or Sunday, not because I don't love you, but because I'm going to be busy. But you're going to have to tell me how those games are going to go, because I really wanted to cast them, and I'm looking forward for this ESL Frankfurt, you know, tournament in general, and I want to watch the qualifiers too. So you got to keep me posted with those.
Or you could check out joindots.com, where all of the results are posted. The match ticker is kept updated. You can see all the scores. You can check out the replays.
I'm gonna have you radio broadcast me while I'm out, and I'm gonna tune in. I'm gonna be listening to Durka's voice and another good co-caster, not Ryu. And I'm going to listen. I'm gonna learn some stuff.
Okay. Sure thing, buddy. Well,
thank you.
For now, good night, guys. That's the end of this cast. We do not have the Ad Finem against Polarity game. That got pushed to tomorrow at 9 p.m. CEST. But we start tomorrow at 11 a.m. CEST. ESL 1 Frankfurt 2016 Southeast Asian qualifiers with Capitalist start then.
So early.
And we go through to midnight with myself. Toby's doing.
And then it's going
to
be a long ass day of Dota.
It is. And then Toby's doing Epicenter, which overlaps with ESL Frankfurt as well. But for now, good night, guys. I'll post social media links in the chat, so make sure to send us cat pictures, food pictures, pictures of tentacles for Ryu, because he loves that kind of thing. But yeah, any feedback, any follows, all appreciated. So good night. See you guys tomorrow.
Good night, fam. Good night, Durka.